But tonight, I'm so pleased to be welcoming the incomparable Ian Frazier to Politics and Prose for his new collection, Hogs Wild, Selected Reporting Pieces. In his work as a staff writer at The New Yorker, and in his 11 books, including Great Plains and Travels to Siberia, Frazier has made a career out of informing us, delighting us, and making us laugh all at the same time. I feel like every single person in this audience has a favorite Ian Frazier piece from The New Yorker, one that made you roar and that you emailed to all of your friends. His piece about a coyote in Central Park, told in the voice of Holden Caulfield, that will be with me probably until the day I die. It's really classic. You should check it out. Hogs Wild is Frazier at his best, roaming, investigating, and touching on everything from cell phones to climate change. As the poet Mark Strand wrote, Ian Frazier is a genius at the tough representation of idiocy, which is everywhere and flourishing as perhaps never before. He has an unerring ear and an unbeatable sense of humor. He is quite simply the wittiest, wildest writer I know. Please help me welcome Ian Frazier to Politics and Prose.
Well, thanks, Liz. The last time I was here, which was I think in 2010 for Travels in Siberia, I had the day free and I went down to the Lincoln Memorial, and then I went to the Vietnam Memorial, and I found the name of somebody that I knew, and it triggered all these thoughts, and I was still thinking about them when I came here, so I just started talking about this guy whose name is on the memorial, and I just talked and talked about it, and was really totally lost all grasp of time. And then I said, well, okay, so now I'm going to read from my book. And I picked my book up, and Barbara, it was in the back going, no, no, no. I had gone on so long that I totally erased all the time that I had. And this time I went again. And so I don't know how much I'm going to talk about Hogs Wild. No, I did learn my lesson, but that particular place, you know, where the Vietnam Memorial is, and then you can go up the steps, and there are always, you can see where Martin Luther King made the speech, because there are always people around it like that, you know, taking pictures of the words in the stone. And then I go into the Lincoln Memorial, and I truly think that's like the most important place in all of the United States. I just, that little nexus there, I mean, it's a huge place, but just those, all within sight of each other, all those different places. And I went there today looking for something. And the one thing I can tell you is that the Lincoln Memorial is kind of falling apart a little bit. I went there in the winter, and there were icicles hanging down from some cracked tiles in the part, the overhanging part. And I hope that is not allowed to continue to get worse, and somebody does fix it. But today I was, you know, just looking at, and all the different kinds of people that are there, it's just so amazingly moving. And there was really not that much different that I took away, except there was a really big, heavyset guy, and he was wearing a t-shirt, and it was a dark colored t-shirt with potatoes on it, like 8 potatoes on it, big potatoes. And then it had a motto on it, and I couldn't read it from a distance, so I sort of sidled up next to him to see what it said. And it said, "Taters, not haters." So I felt like my day was totally justified. I don't know. And instead of going on for 40 minutes, I'll just leave you with that. Taters, not haters. This book has all different kinds of stories in it. It's of lots of different subjects. One thing that does run through it is a kind of fascination that I have with invasive species and with different kinds of animals that just find a way to live locked in with the way human beings live and live close to humans, but remain wild. And so The title piece, Hogs Wild, is about feral hogs. And it was an assignment. My editor, Susan Morrison at The New Yorker, said, you might be interested in this subject, and gave me just a little bit of material on it. And I started looking into it, and I did become interested in it. It is a truly fascinating subject. When I started out, and this is something that happens now all the time with reporting, that when you go out, you now have the internet to deal with, always. Because first, people look you up on the internet and decide what they think of you before you interview them. But more often, what happens is that the subject itself has an internet life, if it's an interesting subject. And so you first have to kind of suss that out. And at the time I started this, there was an internet sort of phenomenon of this giant hog on the internet, Hogzilla. And there was a picture of Hogzilla after he'd been shot. He was hung up with somebody, you know, and he was a huge hog. And he was like 10 feet long and weighed 1,000 pounds, which is just an astonishingly huge hog. And he had then been buried. I don't know why, but the people who shot him buried him. And then they put a cross on the grave, which is also a little peculiar. And National Geographic somehow got involved. And they were going to get to the bottom of this. So they went in and they got a wild hog expert to look at this. You know, they were wearing hazmat suits by this time. And they examined this hog. And the guy decides that it was a fraud, that it was a wild pig, but that it had been pen-raised. He could tell by the wear on the hooves that it had been pen-raised. And so that was Hogzilla. And when I would go someplace, people would say, but what about Hogzilla? So I'd have to deal with that. And then after Hogzilla, there was a female giant hog, Hogzelda. And I also looked into that, and the same guy checked it out, and Hogzelda was also a fraud. And then the final, in this, these things come in threes, the final giant hog was Hog Kong. It was another hog that someone had pen-raised and then pretended was a wild hog. But anyway, so I got through that phase. And I live in New Jersey where we don't have wild hogs yet. And people would kind of say, what? Wild hogs? What's the problem? So that was the first, after I got through the Hogzilla, you know, obstructions. That was the thing that I had to deal with. So I'm going to read the part, a little part in my piece about that particular question. Next question. What do wild hogs do that's so bad? Oh, not much. They just eat the eggs of the sea turtle and endangered species on barrier islands off the East Coast and root up rare and diverse species of plants all over and contribute to the replacement of those plants by weedy invasive species and promote erosion and undermine roadbeds and bridges with their rooting and push expensive horses away from food stations in pastures in Georgia and inflict tusk marks on the legs of these horses and eat eggs of game birds like quail and grouse and run off game species like deer and wild turkeys, and eat food plots planted specially for those animals, and root up the hurricane levee in Bayou Sauvage, Louisiana, that kept Lake Pontchartrain from flooding the eastern part of New Orleans, and chase a woman in Itasca, Texas, and root up lawns of condominiums in Silicon Valley, and kill lambs and calves and eat them so thoroughly that no evidence of the attack can be found. And eat red-cheeked salamanders and short-tailed shrews and red-backed voles and other dwellers in the leaf litter in the Great Smoky Mountains, and destroy a yard that had previously won 2 Yard of the Month awards on Robins Air Force Base in central Georgia, and knock over glass patio tables in suburban Houston, and muddy, pristine brook trout streams by wallowing in them, and play hell with native flora and fauna in Hawaii, and contribute to the near extinction of the island fox on Santa Cruz Island off the coast of California, and root up American Indian historic sites and burial grounds, and root up a replanting of native vegetation along the banks of the Sacramento River, and root up peanut fields in Georgia, and root up sweet potato fields in Texas, and dig big holes by rooting in wheat fields irrigated by motorized central pivot irrigation pipes, And as the 900-foot-long pipe advances automatically on its wheeled supports, one set of wheels hangs up in a hog-rooted hole, and meanwhile, the rest of the pipe keeps on going and begins to pivot around the stuck wheels, and it continues and continues on its hog-altered course until the whole $75,000 system is hopelessly pretzeled and ruined. Oh, them hogs. Noses with bodies and legs appendaged, bristled vacuum cleaner bags attached to snouts is what they are. The hogs' noses actually have a special bone in them called the nasal sesamoid bone, which is connected to the skull only by cartilage and which provides extra rooting support for the rhinarial disc, the pig's nose, the business end, with its two hypersentient staring nostril holes. Wild pigs' noses soon become calloused from rooting and are generally muddy. Sometimes a pig will stop in the middle of rooting and raise its head and blow dirt out its nose. Pigs have a powerful and highly nuanced sense of smell. They can detect scent coming from as far away as 7 miles cross-country and from 25 feet underground. To reach islands, wild hogs have been known to cross tracts of open ocean as much as 2 miles wide. They are very good at swimming, a skill their environment often requires. Floods seldom inconvenience them seriously. In Bayou Sauvage, the New Orleans Wildlife Refuge, wild hogs swam to high ground after the hurricane and came through fine. Shelley Stays, operations specialist at the refuge, says law enforcement people who patrolled there after the hurricane dispatched a lot of hogs. "We've still got plenty of them, though," she says. "They could have shot 100 without making a dent in how many hogs we've got here." Well, I went down to Georgia on a couple occasions, and I spent a lot of time with wild hog experts, scientists who keep track of wild hogs. And in Augusta, there is an organization, the Southwest Wildlife Consortium or something. It's a group of southwestern states that have organized this group to keep track of where the wild hogs are and what they're doing, and also to study other wildlife diseases. These are really intrepid and amazing scientists who go out in the woods and out in the swamps and live out there and, you know, take nasal swabs from wild hogs they've trapped and you know, find out where the hogs are and what diseases they have. And I really enjoyed hanging out with these people. And one of them, everybody that deals with wild hogs has a kind of mixed feeling, like, oh, they're horrible. But then on the other hand, an admiration just for the way the hogs can just keep on living and their tenacity and their toughness. And this guy, the scientist, Joe Korn, told me that they trap them and they would have them in a little enclosure that's about like chest high. And it doesn't have a top to it. And he said, you know, and you can just lean over and look down at the hogs. He said, but don't ever do that. And I said, why not? And he said, because they'll jump up and bite your face. Joe Korn knew county by county throughout the United States where wild hogs were. When I started doing this piece, which was in 2004, they were in 28 states, and by the time I was done, they were in 31 states, and I believe they're now in 39 states. So there's no letting up on the progress of wild hogs, as far as I know, in the last few years. And he happened to have, he wanted me to see this map. It was a map of the lower of the continental U.S., and it was a county by county map. It was a great big map that he rolled out on a table, and you could look county by county and see if that county had wild hogs. And if it did have wild hogs, he had colored it in. It was this beautiful, like, project that they had done, and it showed, you know, both in detail and in the big picture, where the wild hog population was. And this was, by this time it was 2005, and as I was looking at this, I happened to have with me the Newsweek that showed the results of the 2004 presidential election. And this was a fold-out map in Newsweek. And it was county by county. And the counties that had voted for George W. Bush were red. And the counties that had voted for John Kerry were blue. And I was just, I looked at it, and I looked at this map of the wild hogs, and the correspondence was uncanny. And I said to the scientist, look at this. This is amazing. I mean, I felt like I had discovered some amazing thing here. And he just said, no, this is beyond my area of expertise. He didn't want to talk about it at all. So I couldn't get it out of my mind. And I found, he showed me how to find that map online. And so I went to it online when I got home and used the Newsweek map and used other information and started seeing just how close the correspondence was. And the correspondence was more than 4 out of 5 counties that had voted for Bush had wild hogs. And not only that, but in places that where Bush had lost, if it was close, that place had wild hogs. So that, like, New Hampshire, which is the only New England state he came very close to winning, and it was quite close there, is the only New England state with wild hogs. And it was true just across the board. And even things like California, which Kerry had won, California has, I believe now, every county in California has wild hogs. But at that time, there were like 2 that didn't have wild hogs. But every other county had wild hogs. And in California, more people voted for George Bush than voted for George Bush in any other state except Texas. So again, the wild hog corollary. And you can see everybody had said, gee, Florida's a toss-up. All you had to do before that election was look at every county in Florida has wild hogs. So I think if anybody here is a political, you know, poll taker, strategist, look at this particular thing. The wild hog presence in a county is a very, very good indicator. I went down to the Okmulgee Wild Hog Festival, which is an event in Georgia, and it's quite an exciting event. It is a kind of like a wild hog rodeo. The thing with wild hogs, if you want to get rid of them, and you can't ever really get rid of them, but if you really want to make a dent in their population, you have to use dogs. And if you use dogs, you have to use the dog guys. And when somebody wouldn't quite know the answer to a question, they'd say, well, you better ask the dog guys about that one. And these are guys that hunt hogs, and they have dogs that are very skilled at this, and they are a very unusual kind of dog. They are mutts, basically, but they're called curs. They're different kinds of combinations of breeds that happen to be really good at finding and pursuing wild hogs. And every so often, they have these rodeo-type events where they bring their dogs and they compete to see whose dogs are best at these different kinds of chasing and baying hogs. That is, you try and get your dogs so they will arrange themselves around the hog so the hog is kind of immobilized looking at them, and then the hunter can sneak up behind the hog and throw him. Wild hogs are kind of slab-sided, and once you get them on their side, they're pretty much unable to do very much at all. So this was a place with a lot of dog guys. And I felt a little bit, you know, uncomfortable, I guess, because the T-shirts that the dog guys wear all kind of say, you know, I'm going to shoot you, basically. I mean, they're rather hostile T-shirts. And with, you know, the Confederate flag, and it'll say, the Confederate flag is everywhere in this particular sport. And like the dogs are wearing Confederate flags. Everything's, and so it'd be a Confederate flag, and then it'll say, if this flag offends you, you need a history lesson. And so I was a little bit at a distance when I saw them because I'm a northerner, I've always been, and I the Confederate flag makes me nervous. And when I talked to them, they were so amazingly not like their T-shirt. They were very, like, inward and meek and kind, not meek exactly, but they were just, there was something very gentle and sensitive and strange. They were so locked into their dogs, and they were just like, how's the dog feeling now? You know, what's the dog up to? Is this dog ready to go? And they're just paying so much attention, and they're so, attached to their dogs, and their dogs are great. You know, I mean, the dogs are just kind of, you know, and they're having a wonderful time. And so I started talking to these guys, and it was very, very strange. It was very much not what I had expected. I expected some sort of, you know, some sort of possibly confrontational situation. And this is, the next part I'm going to read is about the king of the boss of the dog guys. And I was with this guy, Robbie Hidalgo, who was a hog hunter, and he was showing me around. At the judging stand, Robbie introduced me to Bob Addison, the godfather of hog hunting, Robbie said, and the founder of the festival. Bob Addison owns a wild hog hunting camp in Abbeville, Georgia. He is slope-shouldered, long-armed, powerful-looking, and more than 6 feet tall. He wore faded camo gear and a brown baseball cap with his hunting lodge's name. In his late 50s, he appears stronger for being that age, and his droopy, pale eyes are somehow made more intimidating, not less, by the thin-frame spectacles he wears. He told me the rules and procedures of the hog baying contest and the details of the judging. He said that good performance dogs, like the ones here today, are usually not the same as good hog hunting dogs who tend to be shy around crowds, but much fiercer in the woods. We started talking about hunting. I asked him if he had ever had any dog killed while hunting hogs. He winced as if I had stepped on his toe. Yes, I have, he said. I have had two dogs killed. Then he said, come on, let's go, I'll show you. He told a contest official he'd be back soon, led us to his immense red pickup, drove out the lane from the parking lot, turned east on the highway, crossed the Ocmulgee River, took another main road, maneuvered down a narrow gravel road, stopped in front of his hunting lodge, and led us inside. The walls of the lodge were covered with mounted heads of hogs and deer. Hog skulls lined the mantelpiece. He took down a skull that had been sawed off just behind the snout. Its tusks were chisel-pointed, several inches long. This hog here killed both my dogs, he said, turning the skull back and forth in his hand. This was a big old boar, lived up around Bonaire, Georgia, 45-50 miles from here. In his life, this hog killed 15 dogs, including my two. He was about the biggest thing around there and didn't fear nothing. He charged a man's truck one time and flattened one of its tires. People called this hog Bear. Well, I went up on an afternoon to see some land I own in the area. It's 300 acres, and sometimes I have field exercises there with my dogs. I let the dogs out of the truck, and right away they throwed up their heads and started baying, and then they went off running through the brush. I could tell by the sound they'd found a terrible big hog. I was by myself. I run in after them and caught up with them, and they had this huge boar, partially bayed and partially caught. I got around behind and took a hind foot and a front foot, and I picked him up to throw him, and the hog stood up with me. Never before or since have I found a hog I couldn't take by myself, but this one I couldn't. I stood there holding him, and he stood there on his hind legs with me for maybe 15 or 20 seconds, but it seemed a whole lot longer, and I could see the dogs in front of him still barking. And finally I had to let him go, and as quick as that, he went and... Bob Addison stopped, his eyes bleak and his lips tight. After a while, he continued. And he cut my bulldog's throat. Then he turned around and killed one of my bay dogs. I couldn't see no tree to get up, so I backed off. He looked at me, and I looked at him, and I said, Bear, we'll be back. And I swear the way he looked at me, he was saying, I'll be back too. I went to the closest pay phone and called Wayne, my trooper buddy, and I said, bring every dog you have, come right now. I also called David, who's big enough to hold 3 mules. We went back in after that hog, and the dog struck his trail and had him bayed minutes later, and we showed up and caught him and throwed him down, and I put the handcuffs on him. Handcuffs? Yeah. Bob Addison said, sure, a lot of hog hunters use handcuffs. They're the best and fastest way to immobilize a hog. You mean like those plastic handcuffs they use at protest marches? Shoot, no, you need steel cuffs to hold a hog. I'm a retired state trooper. I use the same kind of cuffs I used on the job. And once we had him cuffed, we lifted him into the back of the truck, and by the time we got home, that hog was dead. Most likely, he went into shock and died. That's what happens sometimes to old boars that have never been captured before. In his very last fight, he cut up but didn't kill three bulldogs. He was a most terrible hog. So this kind of rodeo event was held out in the woods. So it was like an arena, but it was just kind of fenced off with different kinds of fencing. And there were trees and everything in there. And the speakers were duct taped to the trees. And there was a pen of hogs, wild hogs that had been captured. And then all the dog guys were there with their dogs ready for the events. At the arena, the bleachers were filling up. People toted drinks, paper plates of food, and babies. Robbie Hidalgo brought me some excellent barbecue his dad had made. I ate it fast, then used the paper it came in to wipe the sauce off my face. I asked Robbie if I'd got it all, and he answered, pretty much. Small groups of black people had found good vantage points from which to watch. Some were right above the entry chute. They talked among themselves at volumes impossible to overhear. Almost everybody else was white. Some boys sported a souvenir I had never seen before, a green inflatable space alien with long bendable arms and legs that could be wrapped around a person as if the alien were holding on. In just a minute, the two-dog baying competition would begin. In pairs, bay dogs would chase a hog, run him down, get on either side of him, herd and worry him, and try to hold him in one spot. The pair that held the hog best for the space of 2 minutes, in the judge's opinion, would win a tall trophy and a couple $1,000s. The hogs would run, snort, squeal, clack their teeth threateningly, charge the dogs, kick up dust, cause the handlers to dodge around trees. The hogs sometimes would be bitten, torn, grabbed, thrown, sat on, and finally shoved back into their pen. Many in the crowd would watch with an almost out-of-body concentration. A man carrying his daughter on his shoulders came and stood near us. The girl was 4 or 5 years old. She had medium-length brown curls and intent dark eyes. She wore flower print sneakers, and her dad held her by them. I imagined her growing to adulthood as one of those strong character Southern women who speak their minds and make people uncomfortable. A fearless old aunt, maybe, or a no-nonsense columnist. Before her dad brought her today, I'm guessing, he had told her she would be seeing dogs and pigs. She had pictured, I'm guessing, dogs like their dog at home and pigs like the ones in the storybook. The first pair of bay dogs entered the arena at the far side of it, a quarter circle around the fence from the hog's gate. The dog's holders bent down and took the clips at the ends of the leashes. Skinny boys climbing on the hog pen banged it to get a hog to move into the chute. Somebody lifted the plywood door. A boy leaned forward and jabbed the hog through the fence bars. The hog came out into the arena and began to trot along the fence's perimeter. The dogs, suddenly released, went streaking toward him. In their many straps and bucklings, they looked like a SWAT team. Striving faces pointed eagerly at the hog. From her high view, the little girl looked at the dogs and at the hog. Her mind took a second to understand what was going on. Then, in a tone of the greatest emergency, with an authority that cut through every noise and rang above the assembly, the little girl cried, "Run, pig, run!" Some people laughed the way a crowd does when a child makes a remark that everybody hears. Some people said, "Aw," in sympathy. The little girl, seeing that the pig had nowhere to run to, began to cry, and her father lifted her down and comforted her. She cried louder when the pig squealed. A woman standing nearby took up the girl's cause, saying, "She's right. What are they doing?" and so on, until her neighbors shushed her. For a moment, we all hesitated, uneasy and off balance. Then we turned back to the business at hand. I'm going to end by reading the first piece in the book. I've lived a bunch of different places, but for a long time, on two different occasions, my wife and I lived in Northwest Montana. And this is a story from when we lived there. It's called By the Road. It was the winter that Bernard Goetz shot the four guys on the subway. The subway vigilante, as news stories called him, had just surrendered to police, and everybody had an opinion about what he did and whether he was wrong or right. I was living in northwest Montana in a house on the side of the Swan Mountains, as far up as you could go before national forest land. Past the Swan Range, behind the house, began the Bob Marshall Wilderness, one of the largest national wilderness areas in the lower 48 states. At the foot of the mountains was the valley of the Flathead River. From clear across the valley, you could see the light above our garage door. When I moved to Montana from New York, I'd thought I was going back to some earlier and better version of America, to an Ansel Adams photograph suspended in time. Of course, Montana isn't like that, nor, as far as I know, is anywhere else. Nowadays, the particular nuttiness of the age surges everywhere instantly, like a magnetic field. Sometimes half the drop-offs at local Montana U-Haul rental places come from California. And whenever upheaval happens there, an earthquake, a riot, the number of refugees seems to go up. A lot of people in Montana aren't so much living there as they are not living somewhere else. That winter, the Bernard Goetz winter, it really snowed. A hard snowfall makes you feel excited and cozy for only about 90 minutes, I found. After that, it becomes irritating, then worrisome, then alarming, and so on, sometimes all the way to panic. Writing, with its limitations at expressing tedium, can't accurately convey the feeling of watching a steady, hard, unpicturesque, windless snowfall come down for days at a time. Snow piled high on our front deck and on our roof. Sometimes the roof's snow mass, warmed underneath by the heat it was insulating, would slide down until it met the snow heap on the deck, and then freeze there, shutting off the front of the house like a security gate. The driveway to that house was 200 yards long and included a switchback. I kept it shoveled through the first several snowfalls, but then gave up. Getting it plowed cost more than I could afford, so my wife and I began parking our cars at a wide part of the road about a quarter mile downhill. One of our neighbors, a man named, let's say, Len Dodd, parked his car there too. Len Dodd had moved here from Southern California, where he had been a policeman. He had been inspired to move by various long-cultivated dislikes and resentments, combined with a general expectation of coming apocalypse. He talked about these topics in a manner that managed to be tight-lipped and loquacious at the same time. He was short and stocky, with a bristly mustache and narrow eyes, and he often wore a billed cap of a wild, vivid paisley pattern that suggested the scrambled contortions of the thoughts inside. Len Dodd thought that the subway vigilante was great. He talked about him often, said that Goetz had taught the punks of the world a lesson, hoped that now more people would start carrying concealed weapons on the subway, and so on. I was still young enough and game enough to argue. One afternoon, we were standing by our cars for a moment before setting out on the long trudge to our houses, and Len Dodd said that Goetz had to shoot the guys because they were threatening him and they were armed. I said that they weren't armed, they had screwdrivers. He said that those weren't ordinary screwdrivers, they were sharpened screwdrivers. I said, I had just read an article discussing the subject, that the screwdrivers were not sharpened. Len Dodd gave me a narrow, in-the-know look, lowered his voice, and said, "That's not what I heard." I looked down the road and up it. Repeated plowings had left the snow berm so high that the tire-packed track in between was like a bobsled run with white walls taller than a person. Snow had fallen the night before, reburdening the trees all the way to the crest of the Swan Mountains, whose topmost spruces and pines stood minutely whitened against the sky like fine-edged crystals of frost on a window pane. The muffling of new snow added an extra hush to the wood's usual silence, and the painfully cold air carried no smell but that of the gigantic blankness of the Bob Marshall Wilderness beyond. Not even a deer had ventured up here for months. Len Dodd's gaze became more intense, as if to convey a hidden truth to me by mental telepathy. "Where did you hear that, Len?" I asked. Thanks. So we have a few minutes for questions, if there are questions. Oh, microphone, right, sorry.
Your two companions in travels in Siberia, have you kept up with them?
Pardon me?
Your two companions from travels in Siberia, you know, the guy who leaves his wife for the woman in the Far East?
Well, that's an interesting question. No, those guys kind of faded off. And the one guy, whose name was Sergei, had told me that he was a robotics expert and taught robotics at some university. And I got a letter from two robotics experts from MIT, one of whom was Russian, who said they'd never heard of this guy. So that was a little strange. The guy who arranged the trip came to my house, and because he was a member of the Explorers Club, still is as far as I know, and came into my house and videotaped my house. And I said, why are you videotaping it? And he said, oh, I would just want to show it to Sergei. Couldn't quite figure that out. A few months after that, Russian spies who had been living in Hoboken moved to Montclair. And if you look on the front page of the Times yesterday or the day before, there's a story about their house in Montclair that says, you know, they were arrested in this house and they were sent back to Russia. And the house is now empty. It's been empty ever since. And I thought it was kind of strange that that they had picked the town that I lived in, and the fact that Sergei is of no known provenance. I don't know who Sergei was. So now there's just all of this kind of strange questions wandering around in my mind. But I do keep track. I do keep up with the guy who arranged the trip. But other than that, the Sergei and Volodya, I don't know what happened to them.
I don't get the hog hunting, the handcuffing. Why don't they just shoot the hogs?
Well, they do sometimes. I don't know why they didn't in that case. But a lot of times they just capture them. I don't know even what they... Sometimes they take them and, you know, shoot them later, or they bleed them out in a way that's better for cooking them or something. I don't know. But they... All I can tell you is that they do handcuff them. What they... There's so much bad stuff that happens to the hogs that it seems like kind of a minor... indignity, but yeah, that's what they do, I guess.
But the goal is to reduce the number of hogs,
right?
And we have way too many of them, and
right. They either shoot the hog then, or they cut its throat or something. I was never at that point of it. I'm too squeamish for that particular part of it. I did go hog hunting, but we didn't get a hog. I saw a hog, didn't have a shot.
At first, I thought maybe the hog dogs were Democrats, but then I realized they're dependent on the hogs for their, so that's probably not the case.
They do not look like Democrats to me. But you know, from what little I know about dog politics, I would not pick them for Democrats. But, They're nice dogs, that much I'll say. And they love what they do so much. It's incredible. After I saw this, I never understood how much dogs love stuff. I don't have dogs. I can make the nicest dog in the world bite me. I have some nervousness around dogs, and they just and they don't like me. And it took me a while. After I saw those dogs, I saw something in a paper in New Jersey about dogs that are used in prisons to find cell phones. They can sniff. They are trained to smell cell phones. And cell phones have a particular smell. And the people who train them make this essence of cell phone, which they gave me a whiff of, and it would knock your head off. You wouldn't believe that that's what your phone smells like. But it does relate to what your phone smells like. It's a familiar smell, but you only get just a little tiny bit of it. When you concentrate that, it will really make your eyes tear up. And they train the dogs with this smell. And so they said, well, we'll show you the people, the dog guys of the New Jersey State Prison system said, if you want to come and see this, and they had a little training place that was like a simulated prison cell block, and they had hidden cell phones in there, and they brought the dogs in, and you know, they just this one command, and the dogs were having so much fun, it was incredible. They hated to stop at the end of the day, and these hog chasing dogs, they were having a great time too. It's like what they were put on the planet to do, and they, and you know, and they're totally also wearing Kevlar, and so they're, you know, if you go, like, just go online and look up curs, C-U-R-S, or hog hunting curs, you'll find all this stuff about them. I mean, they have all this different kinds of equipment that they wear, and it's a whole world.
Well, you have me so interested, I'm going to keep the questions going here on wild hogs. And I don't know anything about wild hogs, and I'd like to know something about the origin of them. How many I assume these are feral.
Right.
Not domesticated, but farm pigs that, you know,
no,
got loose.
These are wild hogs that have been wild. Okay. There are pigs that get away, and mm-hmm. they're pigs that are released sometimes when people can't keep their livestock, when you have huge price crashes and stuff like that. But the wild hogs come from the Spaniards, and they were in that part of Georgia. I think it was DeSoto. I'm not sure, but there was an expedition that went through there, and some of their hogs got away. And Cabeza de Vaca, who came through Texas on that expedition, also lost hogs. And so that when you go now to the genetic makeup of American wild hogs, you find gene sequences that don't exist, if I'm getting this right, that don't exist in any domestic pig anymore, and that are closely related to Spanish pigs that don't exist anymore either. That, I mean, that this is like, these are descended from Spanish pigs that escaped. And on the frontier, you didn't pen up your hogs generally. You just let them run around. I mean, they were very good at kind of policing the area, because they kill snakes, and they'll eat rattlesnakes. You know, they're very good at, you know, just kind of getting rid of vermin and stuff around, if that's what you want to have done. And then they would live out in the woods, and when it was butchering day, the frontier people would bring all their hogs in to butcher them. And as I say in the book, many hogs chose to skip this event. And so then they bred with the wild pigs that were already out there. So their generations go back and back and back. Although the oldest wild hog in the U.S., the ones with the longest pedigree are in Hawaii. That escaped when people brought pigs to Hawaii back whenever Hawaii was settled, and that then later bred with pigs that were brought to Hawaii by sailing ships and so on. Mm-hmm. But in some cases, they are descended from wild boars that were brought here for hunting ranches, you know, for places where you have game farms that where people can go out and hunt, and that's where the wild hogs in New Hampshire are escapees or descended from escapees. So that's one of the ways. And then the other thing that happens is that people in places like Ohio and Illinois and Indiana, this is what one of the theories is, that did not have wild hogs and wanted to hunt them, went down and trapped them and then brought them back and released them. So that it's thought that the reason that they're in some northern states is for that, you know, purpose. But they're rather distinct from domestic pigs, even mm-hmm. though they have crossbred.
Great, thanks.
You're welcome.
I had a question, which was, I was interested that you said the genesis of the article was an assignment. It was something that was given to you. When you're given these assignments, are you always able to find some way in? Are some more of a struggle than others? Now you have such passion for hogs. Like,
right.
I can't, was this, how do you approach that when it's more difficult to kind of find your angle in or the thing
that can
that
be very difficult
you?
And it can be impossible.
Right.
You know,
so sometimes,
you have to use some discretion in what idea you say you'll do mm-hmm. to see whether you think you would be interested in it. But I haven't, you know, sometimes you'll find a subject that's really great, but it doesn't have any plot.
Right.
You know, and the thing about wild hogs was it did sort of have a plot. Mm-hmm. Which is like, they're coming, you know? and the National Geographic special, was the second most popular special they ever did. I think after some shark thing that they did. I think it was a huge, huge hit. And so there you think, that sounds good, you know, for a book. I now sort of almost wish I'd done a whole book on wild hogs because it's got a national quality to it, you know? I mean, my next book's going to be about the Bronx, and I don't know, was everybody going to care about it? I love the Bronx, but wild hogs, you can kind of worry about wherever you are, except a few real desert states. Wild hogs have sebaceous glands that do not produce sweat, so they have to be in soggy places. But they're wild hogs now, or there are boars in a game farm in Alaska. So who knows, you know, I was reading everything about wild hogs when I was doing this, and I would just kind of find these news flashes like wild boars exist in England now, and they haven't existed since like the 8th century or something, or the 10th century, but they're back, you know, there are many thousands of wild hogs in Australia. And the one weird thing about that was Australia did not like George W. Bush. So the wild hog thing doesn't seem to work overseas.
It's very dry.
Australia, yeah, I don't know where they live in Australia. But
hi.
Hi.
About topics, bags and trees. Did you just decide to do that for fun with your friend,
right.
Or was that, you know, a topic assigned to you?
Oh no,
or
that was.
How does something like that?
That
or
was
do you
just,
do something like that because you're a writer, so you want to experience, you know?
That started as something that I just saw and that irritated me. I saw bags and trees, and there's, you know, in dreams begin responsibilities. You know, I mean, like you see something and it catches your eye, and then you have to do something about it if it's like a real noxious thing like bags and trees. So that has just gone on and on and on in my life. I started it when my daughter was like 2 years old, and my daughter is now 27. And I would just see them and they would bug me. And some people that I've told about bags and trees will actually say, why did you tell me about that? Now I see them and I would rather not see them. And we invented a device that takes the bags out of trees, and we did not get it patented originally because there was a fruit picker invented in 1848 or something that constituted prior art, they said. And so we slightly modified what we did, and then we made a video, and we said, you know, there were no bags, plastic bags in trees in 1848. So on that argument, we did finally get a patent. And then we went around all over the five boroughs, all in different parts of the United States, Missouri. We did a cleanup of the LA River, Massachusetts, Rhode Island. We've done them a lot of different places. And then we got kind of old. It's not that much fun. It's sort of hard work. And so we slacked off on it. And then people started with this business of they're going to outlaw plastic bags. And that had never occurred to me, ever. That's brilliant. This woman who we met when we were doing it said, you know, in Ireland, plastic bags in trees are called witches' knickers. When she told us this, Ireland was, you know, besieged with plastic bags in trees. Ireland put a 15 euro cent charge on all plastic bags, and within like a year or 2 years or something, reduced plastic bags in trees by 95%. And I was staggered by that. And I realized that I was dealing with this problem in the way that we're always taught to think, which is this privatized way of do it yourself, you know? You get out there, take the bags out if it bugs you so much. Doesn't bother me. You don't like them, get rid of them. And so we're out there, you know, like Don Quixote against the windmills, just, you know, there's billions of plastic bags. We'll never get them out. And some genius thinks to make them illegal, and suddenly there's a much less of a problem. And it staggered me that I had not thought in terms of group action at all. I'm still flabbergasted by it. So I just did a piece for The New Yorker about the fact that the city council voted to put a 5-cent charge on plastic bags. It was very controversial. Many city council members were very opposed to it, but it did pass. And it was supposed to start in October, and then the plastic bag industry, which it will spend millions of dollars to defeat these things, and the people that are trying to put the charge on the bags are just working for themselves, and, you know, they're totally pro bono, but the plastic bag industry will spend millions on this, spent millions on the New York State Legislature, which is going to pass a law making it illegal to make plastic bags illegal. So that's where we are now with plastic bags.
Good. Well, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
This was absolutely delightful. Thank you.
You're welcome.